Welcome back. In the previous lecture, we realized that there are three different ways of looking at the polarization qubit. While this could be perceived as an ambiguity, as an arbitrariness, in fact, it points to an underlying abstract notion that we will explore in this lecture. So at the end of the last lecture, we had established that the different binary alternatives that we consider for the photon polarization, vertical versus horizontal, diagonal, anti-diagonal, right-handed, left-handed, circular polarization, that they come with matrices that we call X, Y, and Z, which have eigenvalues plus and minus one for the various polarizations. Now, the X matrix, by the way, we have seen earlier. At the time, this was called the flipper. Now, if we look at the V selection and the A selection, these matrices are very closely related to the Z matrix, because if I take the do-nothing matrix, which is the identity, so I take the identity, 2x2 identity, let me write this for that, and I add the Z matrix to it, well, just do this, okay, what do you get? You get twice the matrix for V selection. So if I take half of that, I get the matrix for V selection. And if I take half of the difference, then that's the matrix for H selection. Well, so let's see if it is true what we may guess, namely that if I take half of the identity plus the X matrix, that should describe a matrix that selects the diagonal polarization. But what do we get? Well, what we get is half of a matrix which has 1, 1, 1, and 1. And this should be a deselecting matrix. Is it true? Well, let's try. Let's apply the 1, 1, 1, 1 to the D direction, the D polarization. So then we multiply with the column that describes a depolarized photon. And what do we get? Well, we get indeed that polarization selected. And if we apply the same matrix, which selects D, to the anti-diagonal polarization, which is this column, then we get zero. So a photon that is polarized diagonally, entering an apparatus describing by this 2x2 matrix, passes through untouched. A photon that is polarized anti-diagonally is sorted out by this apparatus, suppressed, doesn't go through. So this is exactly what the deselection does. And now we can easily see that it is also true if we take the difference of the 2x2 identity minus the X matrix, which is half of 1 minus 1 minus 1 1, that will do an A selection. But rather than multiplying matrices with columns to verify that, let's think about it. Suppose we apply the 1 minus X to the A polarized column. Well, the identity just has value 1 because it has value 1 for all polarizations. Okay. The X matrix has value minus 1 for the A polarization. So we get 1 minus minus 1, that is 2, divided by 2 is 1. So this matrix will have value 1 for the A polarization. So it just multiplies this column by 1. It doesn't do anything to it. However, for the D polarization, we have value 1 minus value 1. So we get 0. So this column gets multiplied by 0. It gets annihilated by this matrix. And so this indeed is exactly what an A selection should do. And likewise, we can conclude that half of the 2 by 2 identity plus y selects the polarization where y has the eigenvalue plus 1, which is the right-handed polarization. So this is the matrix which says half of 1 minus i 1. So that does an R selection. And finally, we have half of the identity minus the y matrix, which is half 1 I minus I 1. And that does the L selection. We can argue the same way that we did for the X matrix. Y has value plus 1 for the right-handed circle of polarization. So here we get 1 plus 1, so that's 2. And the overall value is 1. And here we get 1 minus 1, and the overall value is 0. And for the left-handed polarization, we have 1 minus 1 here, and 1 minus minus 1, which is 2 divided by 2, equals to 1 here. So what we observe is what we can do with our original binary alternative of vertical and horizontal, where we had these matrices for V selection and A selection, we can do exactly the same things for the two diagonal polarizations, and use that as the fundamental binary alternative. Or we can use the two circular polarizations. And for them, we also have the same kind of machinery. And so we can also use these polarizations as our fundamental alternative. So we can use the vertical horizontal alternative that goes with the matrix Z, or we can use the diagonal anti-diagonal alternative which goes with the matrix X, or we can use the right-handed left-handed alternative which goes with the matrix Y. They're all on equal footing. But what does this say about our generic polarized photon for which we have the column that we have, where we have alpha and beta as the column entries? Well, what this really means is that we have the column for vertical times alpha plus the column for horizontal times beta. But rather than referring to vertical and horizontal, we can also refer to diagonal polarization and anti-diagonal polarization, where now the coefficients would have to be alpha plus beta divided by square root of 2 and alpha minus beta divided by square root of 2. Let's check. If I look at the top entry, I have alpha plus beta here, I have alpha minus beta here, so if I add them up, I get 2 alpha, but I also have 2 factors of square root 2. So I get 2 alpha divided by 2, which is exactly alpha. And for the bottom entry, I have alpha plus beta, from which I subtract alpha minus beta, so I get 2 beta, again divided by 2, gives me 1 beta. And finally, I can refer to the right-handed polarization and the left-handed polarization, where I now have the coefficients alpha minus I beta divided by square root 2 and alpha plus I beta divided by square root 2. Let's again verify. Here I have alpha minus I beta plus alpha plus I beta, so I get 2 alpha divided by 2 times this, 2 factors of square root 2, so that's a single alpha. And for the bottom entry, I have I alpha plus beta minus I alpha plus beta, so I get 2 beta divided by 2 factors of square root 2, so that gives me a single beta. So here I refer to the diagonal polarization and the anti-diagonal polarization, and here the reference is to right-handed polarization and left-handed polarization. So this the same polarized photon has amplitudes alpha, beta, if I talk about vertical and horizontal, has amplitudes alpha plus minus beta divided by square root 2 if I refer to diagonal and anti-diagonal linear polarization, and it is amplitudes plus minus I beta divided by square root 2 if I talk about right-handed and left-handed polarization. So it is just like having vectors in three-dimensional space with these kinds of coordinates or these kinds of coordinates or these kinds of coordinates, depending on which kind of coordinate system we are using. So these are really different coordinate systems that describe one and the same polarized photon. So there must be something much more abstract than these numbers, something that just is an abstract geometrical object, just like we talked about a vector that has different coordinates and different coordinate systems, but it's one and the same vector, the one and the same geometrical object. So the vectors that we have here, those are vectors that we call kits. So for a ket, we just write the symbol. So this is a generic ket. If we want to distinguish different kets, then we could have ket number 1 and ket number 2, or ket labeled by U, or a ket labeled by lambda, and so forth. So we have this ket symbol, and whatever we write inside is a label that helps us distinguish different kinds of kets. So if we talk about the vertical and horizontal, well, we will have the ket for vertical polarization, and we will have the ket for horizontal polarization. And their numerical representation, if we refer to the vertical horizontal basis, are the columns 1, 0 and 0, 1. So those are the coordinates for the V ket and the H ket in the basis that refers to vertical and horizontal. So it's just like basis vectors in a vector space. But with reference to the same basis, we have the ket for the diagonal polarization, and that would be represented by the column that we have already met earlier. And for the anti-diagonal representation, we now see that the column that we wrote down earlier is the column that refers to the basis made of vertical and horizontal. Likewise, for the right-handed and left-handed circular polarization, where we have these columns for the numerical representation that refers to the vertical and horizontal set of reference kets. So now let's translate these statements. We have the generic polarization ket, and this now says it's the vertical ket times alpha plus the horizontal ket times beta. Okay? So let's separate these reference kets, vertical horizontal, from the coefficients alpha beta. And we do that by converting the sum of products into a product of a row and a column. So here we have a row of reference kets, and this is a column of amplitudes. Now, well, we can also use the diagonal, anti-diagonal kets for reference, and then the amplitudes would be alpha plus beta divided by square root 2 and alpha minus beta divided by square root 2. That just repeats the statement of this line. Diagonal, anti-diagonal, amplitudes alpha plus beta and alpha minus beta divided by square root. And finally, we can represent the same ket by referring to right-handed and left-handed polarization, and then have alpha minus I beta divided by square root 2 and alpha plus I beta divided by square root 2 for the column of amplitudes. So it's one and the same ket written in three different ways as a row of reference kets, vertical horizontal, diagonal anti-diagonal, right-handed left-handed, and the corresponding column of amplitudes. So if we look for a numerical representation of this polarization ket, we can use this column, or we can use this column, or we can use this column. None of them is better than the other. But if we write down a certain column that represents a particular ket, we have to also say what is the reference, what are the reference kets, what is this row of reference kets that goes with this column. We can use this column, we can use this column, we can use this column, but if I just tell you which column we use, but not what are the reference kets, then that's a useless piece of information. We need to know both. We need to know the coordinates, which is this column of amplitudes, and the basis to which the coordinates refer. In summary, the polarization qubit is described by a ket, which is represented by a two-component numerical column. We have different columns for different choices of reference kets. In the next lecture, we will see how each ket is naturally paired with a partner that we call bra.